Well, good afternoon again, everyone. Welcome to another Performance Insights. Just to let you know, next March, March the 2nd, the next concert will be my last lecture for this season. So I've got something a bit different planned for that, so try to make it if you can. I think it'll be fun. So today we have a prominent clarinetist playing a prominent clarinet work, the Mozart Quintet. So I thought today I would talk a bit about the clarinet, the history of the clarinet. Clarinet family is the largest of the woodwind family. The smallest one down here, that's the E-flat soprano, and that is the B-flat contrabass. The one we're concerned with today is that one. That's the what's called, the, when you think of the clarinet, that's what we talk about, the B-flat clarinet. Now, there was a precursor to the clarinet, and it was this instrument, the shalumeau. Very small instrument, and you can see it has a reed like clarinet, and it's bound on with string, with twine. And it first began to be written about in the 1600s, but it probably existed long before that. And you notice also that the reed is on the top of the instrument, not on the bottom of the instrument. And that's the way it was always played, and that's not the way it's played today. This is what you usually see, the reed on the bottom, contacting the bottom lip. It had a very limited range. As you can see, it only had those six, seven holes. So the range was very limited. And it had an unusually low pitch. So you would think for an instrument that's that small, it's about the size of a piccolo, why would it have such a low pitch? Well, it was because it was a stopped tube. It didn't run the whole way through. It was cut off solid at the bottom. And it had a wide bore, much wider than a piccolo. But it was well known by organ makers that if you had a pipe of a certain length and you stopped it up, you would get a pitch one octave lower. So a lot of organ makers that wanted to make like a 32-foot stop, you know, pipe 32 feet high, they would make a 16-foot pipe, and usually out of wood, and they would plug up the top. And that would effectively sound the same as a 32-foot pipe. So that's why that thing sounds so low. But it was even for its limited range, it was a very expressive instrument. Now, there was a piece by Vivaldi. It's an oratorio called Giuditha Triumphans. And he had an aria in there that uses the shalumeau in the imitation of a dove. Beautiful use of that instrument, and it sounds like we think of a clarinet today sounds. Now, to counter the limited range, it came in a variety of lengths. The one we heard is that one right there. And this man, really happy-go-lucky looking guy, Johann Christoph Denner is credited with inventing the clarinet in around 1700. He was a maker of flutes and oboes, and I used to have a copy of one of his oboes. And what he did was he put on what they call a register key on the back of the shalimo. And it was probably that one. You know, that looks a little bit more like a clarinet today, but what a register key does is throws the pitch up by an octave. On an oboe, it would be an octave, but on a shalimo, because it's a cylindrical bore, it raises it by a 12th. That's an octave and a fourth. So now you had quite a bit expanded range. And when he first did this, this instrument didn't have the name clarinet yet. It was called a mock trumpet. And the reason was that it, let me just play you what it sounded like. You'll see why it was called that. See, now it was starting to play up in the high trumpet range. So where it got the name clarinet was the Baroque trumpet. Now we're talking the 1700s here, so we're still in the Baroque period. The Baroque trumpet, one of the names of it was clarino. And when it started to play up in that range, they called it the mock trumpet. So then, but then clarino and clarinet, small clarino. So that's where the name clarinet came from. But the low register, the one that you heard the shalimo play, it's interesting because that name shalimo is still spoken about of modern clarinet when playing in that range. They call it playing in the shalimo range. And when they're up high, they're in the clarino range. So those terms are still around. The earliest written music that has been found so far, the clarinet, was in 1716 in a book of tunes published in Amsterdam. And by 1720, it had a bell attached to it, made it longer. And you can see the reed is still up. And the playing with the reed opposite, the reed down, wasn't described until about 1800 in Germany. So up through the period of Mozart, and the quintet that we will hear today probably was played with the reed up. Now the reason you don't see that anymore, in all my years of playing with period instrument clarinets, I think I've only seen it once, and that was just as a trick. Because clarinetists today are trained, first of all, in the modern clarinet with the reed down. And you're not going to switch it around because you're not trained that way. And conductors don't care. They don't care how you play it. They just want it to sound good. And the way it's going to sound good is you play it like you know how to play it. Now, the clarinet that Mozart would have known is this one. And this is the one that was written for the Mozart quintet that we're going to hear today. Reed is still up. And it's interesting how they mounted the keys. You see, this had one key, which is duplicated here. But these lower keys, how they did it was they had a larger piece of wood that was still left on the instrument. There was a pin. You can see a little bit better here. A pin was drilled through the, and it went through the key so that would, you know, you could play the key. There was a little spring underneath here, but that's how they mounted the keys. There's the other one. And it came in four varieties, pitched in D, C, B flat, and A. And in the Mozart operas, you will see, if you can see the pit, in a period instrument orchestra, they will change. They have to change because Mozart wrote parts for predominantly the C, B flat, and A clarinet. So you need, if you play a Mozart opera, you need all of those. Now, developments in the 1850s, it starts to look like the modern clarinet. And you'll notice the mountings. The key mountings are different. No longer do you have the extra wood here to support the keyhole, but you've got little posts with rods through them. There you can see that one, the little rod that goes through. Now it starts to look like a modern clarinet, which is this one. Comes apart in five sections. And here's the reed. It's that's this business here is called the ligature, and all that does is clamps the reed onto the mouthpiece. You'll see in the shalimo it was bound on by string. That's usual. Well, in fact, in Europe, they still do that. I'll show you a picture of, here, different ligatures. And you can see it's still bound on by string there. And if you see a YouTube video of a German orchestra, they still use it that way. These are different kinds of ligatures that you can get. Here's one that's just a strap that goes around. And here, this looks like a medieval torture device. I'm not sure if I was a clarinet player, I'd want that on my bottom lip or not. And this is really an odd one here. I mean, it's a combination of this and that. You know, you have this screw thing which tightens the cord. And the clarinet today is made of African blackwood. It's a very hard wood. Oboes are made of that also. But one of the reasons they use it is because the boxwood, which was the upper three, was a traditional wood for instruments in the 1800s. It's a very soft wood, and it's a very unstable wood. If you're blowing warm air into it, it can expand and contract. And if you've got these long rods here on the if you try to do that on that, you would find out pretty quickly that they would start to bind up. So to have a stable wood to accommodate all that hardware, you had to have a really hard wood, and Granadilla is the one that's used today. And at the turn of the 20th century, they started making clarinets out of metal. These were primarily outdoor instruments, marching bands, but they turn up in early 20th century jazz bands too. They're quite popular, and you can get them in. You can get them in any color you want to. So today we're going to hear the Mozart Clarinet Quintet, written in 1789. It wasn't written for that clarinet that you saw previously. It was written for the basset clarinet. That's that long one there. You can see how much longer it is than the 18th century clarinet. Why it got the name basset is small bass. It had ranged four notes lower than the normal clarinet, so it was kind of a small bass et basset. And don't confuse it with the basset horn, which is a different instrument altogether. That's even lower than the basset clarinet. It goes like a whole fourth below the basset clarinet. Corno di Bassetto is the name in Italian, and that's the name that Mozart used when he wrote for it. Does that name ring a bell with anybody? George Bernard Shaw, his pen name when he wrote music criticism was Corno di Bassetto. Mozart used that instrument quite a bit, but it kind of, after 1850, it kind of vanished. But then it popped up again. Richard Strauss in his opera Elektra in 1909 had a part for basset horn. It wasn't this one. It was a modern version. Now here is a modern clarinet and a modern basset clarinet. Now you can see these two holes right here are analogous, but you've got four more down below. And here again, look at the length of these rods. Like I said, you needed a very stable wood to accommodate that. Now the quintet that we're going to hear today was written for this man, Anton Stadler. And also Mozart wrote his concerto for him, the clarinet concerto. And both of them were written for the basset clarinet. Now, early, you may pick up a recording of the concerto or the quintet, and it may not be played on the basset clarinet. Earlier recordings usually didn't do it, but later recordings, more up to the modern time, and especially if it's a period instrument, recording, they will actually use the basset clarinet. Mozart really loved the clarinet. In fact, there are several pieces where he wrote for no oboes and only clarinets. The 39th Symphony in E flat has no oboes, clarinets. Piano Concerto 22 and 23, the same way, just clarinets. And it's amazing the sound of the orchestra, how it changes so much just by the subtraction of the oboes. I mean, there's a brilliance that the oboes, even when they have very incidental parts, brings to the orchestra. But you take that away and just have clarinets, there's a much more mellow sound to the orchestra. And he has prominent parts, most of prominent parts in The Marriage of Figaro, Così fan tutte, and a big virtuoso solo in La Clemenza di Tito for the basset clarinet. Now this is the sole surviving clarinet quintet that Mozart wrote. There are two others that both are in fragments, but this is the only complete one. They've tried to reconstruct the other ones. There's one in B flat that has a complete development section, but people have tried to, from sketches, to fill that out. So I'm going to play you the first four notes of the clarinet quintet, and I want you to tell me what it sounds like. Anybody? East side, west side, right? So, hear it again. So now I have just spoiled this piece for you for the rest of your life. I mean, I can't hear it without hearing east side, west side. So I'll play the beginning of that on a period basset clarinet. Now in a modern. More vibrato. Thank you. very similar, but the modern clarinet is more robust. You can play it a lot louder than you can the period instrument. So now I'm going to play you the complete exposition. You have a little bit better idea of this piece. Goes into the second theme at this point. I'm going to play you the development. What I think is fascinating at the start of this is how Mozart goes from E major, which is four sharps and four flat, four sharps, no flats, and no, four sharps, to C major, which is no sharps, no flats, in the space of three bars, how he gets there. He has an E major chord, then an E minor chord, then he adds one more note, all of a sudden you're in C major. So I'll play the whole development until you'll notice when we're coming home, back to the home key, the clarinet will just hold out a long note, and all at once we're back on the east side. E major, minor. Different key, completely different key. Starts to modulate. Every bar is in a different key. Back home. The third movement has, you can see it has two trios, trio one and trio two, and it is in this form. Usually a minuet and trio is A, B, A. So two trios, so it's A, B, A, C, A. So you're going to hear that minuet part three times. The first trio is for strings alone in the minor key, but the second one is for clarinet. A very nice little bit of playing for the clarinet. Mm-hmm. And the last movement is a trio and an allegretto and four variations, theme and four variations, with a coda. The fourth variation features, again, the clarinet. Those figures are very, very characteristic of what a clarinet can do. And Mozart really took advantage of that in his writing. Here is the coda. Shift gears, and we're going to have quiz time, followed by Name That Tune. So I'm going to show you a picture, and you tell me who the clarinetist is. So the first one is a gimme. Very good. All right, what's he playing? Good. Now, he was also a clarinetist that performed with symphony orchestras, and he recorded this quintet and the Mozart concerto at least twice. And he also recorded Bernstein, Copland, and who's that other one? Stravinsky. And the Nielsen concerto. And the Weber concertos. So he was very prolific. He didn't stick to one kind of music at all. Okay, next one. No? Anybody? Buddy DeFranco. I'm here, I don't know. Mr. Clarinet. Okay, you'll notice, you'll be able to guess what he plays. Autumn Leaves. Feel free to get up and dance, if you want. Love the suit. Love the suit. No? Artie, I heard, who said Artie Shaw? Somebody said Artie Shaw. Yeah, okay, Artie Shaw, right. What's he playing? Next. No. Any guesses? Woody Herman. What was the name of his band? Right. Thundering Herd. Okay, you get extra credit if you can name the singer. You got to name the tune and the singer for complete credit. After you've gone.
After.
Any guesses as to the singer? Nope. Edie Adams. Who was her husband? Ernie Kovacs. Yeah. How many watched the Ernie Kovacs show?
No.
Only a few, so you probably don't know who this is then, do you? Percy Dove Tonsils. Okay, so enough of that. Back to the clarinet. Okay. So here's another piece for extra credit. This is Woody Herman again. And you, if you get this one, I'll be really impressed. What's it sound like, that last bit? Stravinsky? The Ebony Concerto. And this is a recording that Woody and the band did with Stravinsky conducting. Okay, back to the easy stuff. Admittedly, this is an early photograph. Pete Fountain. And the music? No? Right, back home again in Indiana. Next. Acker Bilk. Oh, that sounds like that doesn't ring a bell for many people. This is one of his theme or hit tunes. Stranger on the Shore. Now this one you may not know. Eddie Daniels, that name ring a bell? No. Oh, he's still around. He's still playing. And you'll know the tune. Very good. It had to be you. And he's another clarinetist that has recorded Brahms and Weber. Didn't know he played clarinet, did you? He was primarily a Dixieland player. So you may not know this tune if you're not a big Dixieland fan. This is him playing. Pretty good for a Dixieland player. So last and probably least, oh, what was the song? It's called Martha. I never heard it. So as I said, last and probably least, Bill, Sergeant Bilko. How many never knew that he played the clarinet? Yeah. So Listen closely to this. You'll get the tune, so don't shout it out because there's something that you don't want to miss.
Thought it was going to be lousy, huh?
Thought it was going to be lousy, and Stardust, of course.
Ladies and gentlemen, what you just heard cost my mother $30,000.
So there you are, a trip through clarinet land. So I hope you enjoy the concert today.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.